Only 350 replies came in at first, but it was the beginning of a mailing list that grew and grew to more than 100,000 names. Official Deadheads received a newsletter and the first word about concerts. Eventually, the Dead would be able to sell out shows by just word of mouth. The Dead weren't playing clubs or ballrooms anymore. They were touring stadiums. That meant they had to put together a professional business operation. It also meant they had to fill bigger places with sound. In 1974, the Dead started touring with what they called the Wall of Sound. It was three stories high and weighed 23 tons, with 641 speakers pumping out 26,400 watts. The sound was magnificent, but the overhead was $100,000 a month. The Dead finished their contract with Warner Brothers in 1973.
We decided, hey, you know, we got to be able to do better than this. We got to be able to be more humane than these people are. We got to be able to be more fair than these people are. Let's just do it ourselves. We might not make as much money, but I guess my bet is we will. We just won't get taken for as much.
Grateful Dead Records made its debut in the record stores in November 1973 with Wake of the Flood, a new studio album. 7 months later, the Dead's label released From the Mars Hotel. But the band was overloaded. Running a record company, touring with a monster sound system, and recording albums were all full-time jobs. Even the cocaine they started using couldn't keep the energy going. It was time for a break, and in October 1974, the Dead announced they were retiring from the road. They finished up with a five-night stand at Winterland in San Francisco. After the shows, the Wall of Sound was dismantled. The Dead gave most of it away, providing sound systems for a dozen smaller bands. The Dead said they hadn't broken up, but to their fans it looked like the end of the road. Garcia formed a bluegrass group. Weir worked with another band, Kingfish. By the time they made the next Dead album, Blues for Allah, Grateful Dead Records was in financial trouble. The soundtrack for the Grateful Dead movie Steal Your Face was the label's last album.
At one point in the mid-70s, we were all carrying briefcases and we had our own record company. That was pushing it too far because it took up too much of our time.
The Dead decided to be a little more businesslike and in mid-1976 went back on the road, but with a manageable sound system and a manageable schedule.
Right outside this lazy summer.
They signed up with Clive Davis at Arista Records, who had some ideas about selling a few albums. For the first time in a decade, the Dead worked with a producer from outside the band. Keith Olsen, who had made huge hits with Fleetwood Mac, produced Terrapin Station. He trimmed away wrong notes and loose ends and stabilized the beat.
It was kind of fun working with different guys for a while and, you know, getting a different slant on the recording process and the whole methodology of it.
The Grateful Dead were getting professional. And if the results didn't seem to mean much at the time, they would in years to come. From the late 1970s onward, the Dead developed a comfortable routine for their 6 months on the road, playing about 70 shows a year. Their concerts had grown to marathons, 3 or 4 hours long. A typical show started with a long tune-up and a set of distinct songs. Then, after a long intermission that might include some of Phil Lesh's electronic music, the band came back for a free-form jam, followed by Hart and Kreutzmann attacking a vast assortment of percussion. In 1978, the Dead decided to play some real blues for Allah and went to Egypt to perform at the pyramids.
So we treated ourselves to a giant 3-week party in Cairo and playing in front of the pyramids for 3 days, which was a dream that we've had, you know, years ago. You know, let's take the Grateful Dead to Egypt.
It was a high-tech pilgrimage that cost the band $500,000. They traveled with more than 100 people and brought 25 tons of sound, light, and film equipment. The band set up between the paws of the Sphinx and played for 3 nights. The Grateful Dead's fans continue to be loyal. Deadheads would take leaves of absence from jobs or school, pile into a van, and follow the band around the country.
It's part of one of the last remaining adventures. You can't ride the rails anymore in America. You know, it's tough to hitchhike even, but you can have an experience out on the road with the Grateful Dead. You can follow the band around for a tour. You can have those kind of adventures.
While the pop market tried out disco and new wave, the Dead had become something to depend on, a rock institution. They had created their own world. But they still weren't selling anywhere near as many records as they were concert seats. For the next record, Shakedown Street, they turned to a different producer, Lowell George, the leader of Little Feat. Some disgruntled old fans complained the Dead had gone commercial, dismissing the album as Disco Dead.
We came up with a couple of disco tunes, or quasi-disco tunes. I won't name them, you'll have to go find them.
George convinced the band to do a Rascals song Pigpen used to sing, Good Lovin'. Good Lovin' got some radio play, but it wasn't the hit they hoped for. There were other problems in the band. Keith Godchow had been struggling for years with depression and hard drugs, Donners and then heroin.
Being in a stupor and trying to play music is irreverent, you know, and it's irresponsible and it's bad form.
By the late 1970s, Keith's playing was going downhill. Sometimes he even nodded out on stage.
Keith and Donna were sort of going into a different direction. They were locked pretty much into their own family drama.
It was like a soap opera, you know, really. It was difficult for both of them, Donna and Keith.
It was taking energy away from the band itself. So it was logical that they move on.
Late in 1978, Keith and Donna Godchow agreed to quit the band. They played their last show in 1979. Just over a year later, Keith Godchow was killed in a traffic accident. A new keyboardist moved into the Dead's hot seat. Brent Midland, who had been working with Weir in one of his side projects, Bobby and the Midnights.
He never got over feeling he was the new guy. So, and he fit right in. I mean, he's an excellent player, an excellent singer, excellent writer.
Midland brought a whole array of keyboards. Not just piano and organ, but synthesizers, giving the music a new sparkle. The Dead made one more album with an outside producer, Go to Heaven. Again, they aimed for music that might get played on the radio. And the single, Alabama Getaway, reached the lower half of Billboard's Hot 100. Although Go to Heaven reached number 23, it was the last album the Dead would make in a studio for 7 years.
We were never a recording band. I never looked at the Grateful Dead in those terms. Grateful Dead was in the moment, live, in front of an audience, and without a net.
In 1980, the band again returned to its roots by opening a series of shows at the Warfield Theater in San Francisco and Radio City Music Hall in New York with acoustic sets. The shows were the source of 1981's live albums, reckoning and dead set. Through the early 1980s, the Dead were a phenomenon. They didn't have an album in the charts, but year in and year out, old fans came to see them, and new fans discovered them.
Well, her parents like it when we come home and say, we're going to go see the Dead, because they've gone and done it themselves.
The Dead looked after Deadheads. They began selling 20 to 40% of concert tickets by mail order, bypassing scalpers and long lines. As the money rolled in, the Dead started the Rex Foundation to give money to worthy causes. Most of the 1980s Deadheads were not grain baby boomers, but the boomers' children. Wearing tie-dyed t-shirts and looking for the spirit of the 1960s in the era of Ronald Reagan and MTV. In the Dead, they heard freedom and risk and teamwork, as well as good time music with deep roots. To the general public, it might have seemed that the Dead disappeared, but the fans and concert promoters knew differently. Wherever the Dead played, they could expect the place to sell out. Year after year, they were one of the highest grossing acts on the concert circuit. Dead concerts became a tribal phenomenon. Deadheads arrived early at stadium parking lots where vendors sold homemade t-shirts, home-cooked food, clandestine drugs, and a huge selection of old Dead concert tapes.
Actually, we sell something that's really different. It's called a Daydreamer, and it's a purple mask that you put over your face, and you blow into a tube at the base, which makes a wheel spin inside, and you look toward the sun and keep your eyes shut, and it sends quick pulses of light through your eyelid, and it stimulates the retina and makes you see spiraling colors and patterns.
Inside the shows, one corner looked like a forest of microphones on poles. It was the tapers section, where the Dead allowed fans to record shows without hassles. Unlike most bands, the Dead weren't worried about bootlegs.
That's what we provide for people is music, and however they want to appreciate it, if they want to have it and hold it on tape, they're certainly free to do that. You know, some of those tapes represent big moments for some people, I guess.
But not all was well. Local police and the Drug Enforcement Administration figured out that there would be drug use at Grateful Dead concerts. They moved in on the parking lot parties, using plainclothes detectives and tie-dyed clothes to bust Deadheads. And quietly, mostly off stage, drugs were taking their toll on the band. Garcia had moved from LSD to cocaine to a potent form of heroin called Persian White. He had been the band's most prolific songwriter and motivator, and as his attention wandered, the band went on autopilot. A few new songs were played on stage as the band continued to tour, but the Dead didn't get around to recording them. As thousands of Deadheads watched, Garcia got heavier and more sluggish. Eventually, the band confronted Garcia to tell him he was destroying himself. They demanded that he make a choice, his drug habits or the band. Garcia said in that case he'd take the drugs. The others backed down.
We knew Jerry's health wasn't good. We had tried to get him into rehab. We tried to do everything. We did everything we possibly could, from just individuals talking to him to the full scale, the whole band going up, marching up, and knocking on his door. He had to do it his way.
In January 1985, Garcia was arrested in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park, where the Dead had played so many times. He was sitting in his BMW, and a cop came over because he saw a lapsed registration. When he searched the car, he found packets of heroin and cocaine. Garcia promised to enter a drug treatment program.
And in fact, he never did go to rehab that time. The reason he got sick was because he tried to quit. And he tried to quit without any medical supervision or help or anything like that.
Jared's a